Hi, hello, my name is Allie and this is my channel where I talk about what I'm knitting, how it's going, and what it's costing me. And today we're going to be getting into a finished object, if you haven't noticed what I'm wearing, the ongoing progress of my WIP, and also some news about a future plan that is becoming more and more real because I have some acquisitions to prep for it. I'm coming to you today from just outside Toronto with some more exciting mug news. It's a big mug season for me, apparently. Now, there's a bit of a backstory to this mug. So this mug is by the artist Yelena James, and I have been following her work for years at this point. Definitely at least two or three, possibly more. And in that time, I've sort of been torn between trying to pick a print of hers to buy, but also some of her smaller originals are actually quite affordable. So I've kind of just been stalking her work for years now, waiting for a small format original that just feels like quite the perfect one for me. You know, the one that sort of encapsulates all the things that I love most about her style. And I've just sort of been laying in wait, waiting for that moment. And then she recently announced that she was working on her first batch of ceramics. And I was like, oh, my time has come. So that is the story of how I now own this beautiful mug that she made and then painted using glazes in a style very similar to her paintings. And it just feels really special because I've been following her work for a long time and I'm really excited to add this one to my collection. And in this mug, I am drinking, if you've been here a while, you can probably guess, my favorite Sloan Classic Earl Grey. And I'm not gonna bother telling you what I'm wearing in this intro segment because we're about to get all into it in my finished objects. So let's go. Okay, so let's get into finished objects. This is my Cloudbow top. So one last rundown on the project stats. This is the Cloudbow top by Reed Keys. There's also a dress variation that's part of the same pattern. This pattern is size inclusive up to a 62 to 66 inch bust, depending on how much of the recommended ease you want, which we love to see. I ended up knitting the size 3, but with the intention of ending up closer to a size 2, just because my gauge was a little tight. And in this case, I did not size up from the recommended needle. And this pattern is out of Pom Pom magazine, which unfortunately means that it's on the pricier side because you have to actually buy the whole magazine. So that cost me 11 Great British pounds or 1942 Canadian, which is a little bit ouch just compared to what I'm used to paying for knitting patterns, but c'est la vie. But there is hope that I might knit other things out of that magazine in the future. Hopefully I can convince myself to do that. And that will sort of retroactively decrease the cost of this project a little bit. Now this project, you'll know if you've been here for a while, that this project was very much led by a yarn purchase in a way that my projects normally are not. Typically, I'm very picky about what pattern I want to knit, and then I decide what yarn I think will be the best fit for that pattern. But in this case, I went to Knit City Toronto and there was a lot of nice yarn and I exercised a lot of self-control and I only bought one yarn. I was not exactly sure what I wanted to do with it, but I had gone in thinking, if you're gonna buy something that you have no real plans for, buy a mohair. Because I knew that Knit City, having a lot of different indie dyer vendors, would have a lot of superwash wool. Superwash seems to be more popular with indie dyers and it's just not my favorite. I just prefer a non-superwash wool. So I was like, okay, the thing that makes more sense for you to look for is mohair, because indie dyers also tend to do a lot of mohair and superwash mohair is not a thing. There's not the same factor to be worried about. And I was also curious about the prospect both of knitting an all mohair top or of knitting something where I'm holding the mohair double something, but where the mohair is kind of fun and interesting, but it's paired with sort of a like plain cream or other neutral base for the other yarn that I'm holding it with. So what I ended up picking up was the silk mohair from the Wandering Flock in the colorway Cosmic Tie-Dye, which was easier to show you when I still had a ball of it to hold up. It was a little bit clearer to make out, but it's basically every color of the rainbow except green, or maybe there even is a tiny bit of green. There's purple, there's pink, there's yellow. I would say that pink, purple, and yellow are the colors that you see mostly, but there are little bits of sort of green and blue in the transitions. So these skeins cost $48 Canadian each, and I bought two of them. So once you added in tax, that brought my total to $108.48 Canadian, and there was no shipping because I bought it in person. So was this cheap yarn? Absolutely not, but at least I didn't pay shipping. Though I did pay $20 to get into the event. So I don't think we get credit for that. So on top of that, once you add in the on the higher end cost of the pattern, that brings our total project cost to $127.90 Canadian or about $94 US. So I cast this on May 25th and I just finished it a couple days ago. One of the lovely things about this fabric is that it blocked very quickly. Like I laid this out to dry before I went to bed and the next morning when I woke up, it was perfectly dry. All right, I'm gonna get up so I can show this to you better.
Ta-da! Look how like cute and flouncy it is. You will also note that the bottom is longer than the front, which is not part of the pattern, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. Here it is from the back. Here it is from the front. Here it is from the side, I guess. So construction wise, this one's kind of interesting. You start with just this front rectangle here. You knit an identical one for the back. And then you pick up here, starting out knitting flat to knit part of your body. And then you actually join in the round to finish the sleeve. And then the sleeves are finished with just a folded over and sewn stockinette. And then after that, you pick up all around to join everything in the round and knit your peplum, doing some increases to create the kind of ruffly effect. And then you also finish off your collar with the same folded over stockinette as the arms. This is just so cozy. I mean, granted, I do not seem to have a sensitivity to mohair. It just feels, I mean, the name Cloudbow is appropriate because I feel like I'm wearing a cloud. Like it's just lovely. Temperature wise, it is interesting. I've never knit anything out of only mohair, and knitting something out of only mohair, particularly at such an open gauge, is also obviously very different than if I were knitting something more solid with it. So I was kind of curious about what is it gonna feel like to wear, like when should I be wearing it? When is it the appropriate thing to be wearing? Now yesterday, we happened to have an unusually mild day. The summer has been so blazing hot here in Ontario. It has been like insufferable. Like poor Copper's been getting much shorter walks than normal just because we can't stand to be outside for an entire hour. We're both like after 30 minutes. But yesterday, it was just like room temperature outside. It was glorious. And I happened to be wearing it because I had pulled it off the block mat and I was excited about it. And I was like, this might actually be an appropriate temperature to wear this. We went out and we walked for an hour, and sure enough, this was perfect. So comfortable at room temperature, at least for me. I run cold. I'm not always the most accurate litmus test of this for other people, so I can't say for sure if that would be the same for you. My friend Brooke always jokes that anytime we show up to something together, we show up dressed for completely opposite seasons, and that is true. This is us in May when we went to the Tulip Festival together. So I find this comfortable at room temperature. Your mileage may vary. It's so like comfy and breezy and cozy. Big fan. It feels very wearable, which is not a thing that I felt confident about going into this pattern. I was okay with the idea that this might be more about using a really pretty yarn and making a garment that is less practical than I'm usually aiming for. But I think we might have accidentally made a practical garment, I guess. Okay, so overall thoughts on the project. I'm really happy with the finished piece. There are definitely some mistakes in it, which I chalk up to trying to knit this one while reading at the cottage, which usually goes fine for me, but there is something about this very tiny lace weight yarn on very large needles that did make it pretty easy to accidentally pick up not just the stitch, but kind of go into stuff like beneath or around it. So there's definitely the odd place, like here on the sleeve, I can find one. Can I point it out so you can see? Like here, can you see there's kind of something weird going on? So there are some things like that just kind of scattered around the top. I also definitely got some laddering on the sleeve here from my magic loop, which is not an issue that I tend to have. So I think that maybe knitting at a very open gauge is perhaps less forgiving of that than usual, or maybe it's the fact that the silk strand has less elasticity than a wool yarn. I don't know. I just do know that the sleeve that I knit with magic loop has a little bit of laddering, and the sleeve that I knit just in the round once I found my shorter needle cord has no laddering. So there are definitely some imperfections in this one, but I also feel like there are things that like I notice because I put them there and I made it and I spent many hours staring very closely at this fabric, but I also don't think they're things that are like very noticeable when you're wearing it. So they don't really take away from my level of happiness with this project. Something I'm really happy about with this project is that I used up all my yarn. Like I was kind of hoping that I could just like keep knitting the peplum part until I ran out, but I did a better job of that than anticipated because I thought that I would end up like erring on the side of caution and then ending up like, oh, I still have like a decent little ball of it left at the end. I didn't want to run out before I bound off. I accidentally was much less cautious than I thought I was being. There's a weird thing, right? Where like as your ball of yarn is getting smaller, it's getting like exponentially smaller because it's winding around a smaller and smaller surface each time. So when I thought I was stopping at a cautious spot, it turned out that I in fact did not have enough to complete my bind off round. In fact, I only got about a quarter of the way around and then was like, oh no. And my first instinct was to try to start ripping it back and rip out a couple of rows and then bind off. But first of all, I'd already ripped back maybe like a sixth of the way around because I'd started doing a standard bind off, but then was finding that for some reason, it really seemed to be cinching things more than I usually find that it does. Maybe this is part of that open gauge thing, I don't know. But I was feeling like it was going to make the peplum do like a bubble instead of just kind of naturally flowing out, which I did not want. So I had to unravel that part of the bind off, but it's mohair, and unraveling mohair is terrible. Like almost every stitch I had to like help it and kind of like break some of the little fluffy strands that had like stuck to each other. It was just bad.
So by the time I had done like a quarter of the bind off, doing it again, this time using the surprisingly stretchy cast off, I was like, I do not want to rip this back again, let alone like not just ripping back this bind off, but then ripping back like 2, 3, 4 more, because the bind off, the surprisingly stretchy bind off, definitely uses more than one round's worth of yarn, because you're basically doing 2 knits onto each stitch. So I was like, I don't want to rip back those many rows of mohair. So I was at the cottage when this happened, and I'd used up all the yarn that I had, but I was like, I wonder if maybe at home there's some more of this somewhere. Like, did I at some point hit a snag in the mohair and got annoyed and just ripped the chunk off rather than like patiently figuring out the knot and continuing on? So holding out hope for my own past impatience, I set it aside, and when I came home, I did in fact find a little scruff of yarn that I had cast aside because I could not be bothered with untangling it. I was like, it's just a tiny bit, whatever, it's fine. And in fact, it was more fine than I would have thought, because I needed that yarn and it was there when I needed it. And I dealt with it, I unpicked the little knot issue, and I also used all of it up and had about 10% left of the bind off to do. And I was like, ugh. So thankfully, in and amongst that scruff, there was also one more strand that was maybe like this long. So I did the sort of thing where you tie like the 2 knots on either side of each other, and then you can like slide them together. So I did that little join in the middle of my bind off and continued binding off, and had enough to complete it by like the skin of my teeth. So this top contains almost exactly 2 skeins of the Wandering Flock silk mohair. Okay, so let's talk short rows, because as you could see in my top, the back is longer than the front, which is not the case in the pattern. Actually, when I tried the top on, when I just sort of knit to the point that the pattern tells you to knit to in the round, equal front and back, when I tried it on, it was distinctively riding up in the back. And I mean, of course it does, because that's how bodies are shaped. Like, this is why so many patterns have short rows either at the back of the neck or somewhere else to sort of raise the back of the neckline, or at the very least add length toward the bottom to sort of compensate when the sweater naturally shifts up that way. But this pattern doesn't. It's just perfectly symmetrical all the way around. And I was like, I don't love the way that this is sitting, so I guess I have to learn how to do some short rows. So in one of my past videos, I was looking for advice on this, because I've knit short rows before when they've been written in patterns, but I have no experience in figuring out how to put them into a garment that doesn't currently have them written into the pattern. So I am happy with how my short rows turned out, but I have to say I'm like a little bit disgruntled that I had to do them. I didn't really mind at the time, but in retrospect, like running back through these project stats, that I paid almost $20 to get this pattern, which is the most I've ever paid for a knitting pattern, that was the one that had no shaping at the back of the neck and required me to figure out my own short rows to not, like, let's be clear, the way that this top turned out, I ended up making the back longer than the front, but that wasn't why I started doing short rows. I started doing short rows because the back was actively shorter than the front, just because of the way that it naturally sits on your shoulders, because human bodies are not symmetrical front to back. So I was just trying to not get it to look weird. That was my goal in adding the short rows, and then I kept going, making it longer. But I would have been perfectly satisfied if this pattern had just had enough short rows or any other version of shaping at the back to make it look the same length as the front. And really, so I'm not a pattern designer, so caveat if what I'm about to say doesn't actually make sense, but in my head I'm thinking, would it not have been possible to just make the rectangle that is the back panel longer than the front panel, and the flat panels that you make for the sleeve would then just have diagonal edges in order to connect the two, and that way when I stand up, this seam that is right here would actually look level front to back, because as it is, it looks higher on the back than it does on the front. You can see as I turn, the way that the top sits, that part sits shifted forward from front to back the way that the whole top does, and on the bottom that's disguised by the short rows that I've added to add extra length only at the back. But because those short rows take place after this line, it does nothing to adjust where that line sits. So a little part of me is like, for a pattern that required me buying a $20 magazine, could it not have integrated some shaping at the back of the neck? But on the other hand, I have no real concept of how pattern designers are paid when their work is featured in a magazine. Like, is it actually maybe the case that magazine pattern designs are actually less comprehensive and less thought through, despite costing the customer more money? Because A, I mean, there's several patterns in a magazine, not just one, even though you have to buy the whole thing even if you just want to knit one. But also, the structure of the magazine introduces a middleman, where the pattern designer isn't just selling directly to you and earning all of the proceeds, but in fact, they are just getting paid by the publisher, and probably a smaller slice than most people would assume. So in that way, like, this is really not a criticism of the pattern designer. I suspect that this is a product of the structure under which this pattern was conceived. But just from their customer perspective of like, I paid more for this pattern than any pattern I've ever bought, and it required kind of the most work from me of any project where I'm not like really going out in left field. Like, yes, I've talked about doing a lot of calculations for the Fausta bralette, but that's because I'm trying to turn the Fausta bralette into the Fausta fitted top. You know, I'm trying to turn it into a garment that fits a part of the body that is in no way accounted for in the original pattern. So that's like a me problem, you know? But I feel like not wanting to have my top weirdly riding up on my back, that feels like less of a me problem and more of a reasonable expectation. So I don't super love that part of this pattern. But the end product is so good, and hopefully if this is one that you're thinking about, my sort of chatting through the short rows can help you figure out how to do that as well in yours. So the video that was recommended to me that I ended up working off of was this one. I'll pop a link in the description box. But she does a really great job of drawing out and sort of explaining to you where your turns should be happening and how to distribute them. And yet, did mine go as planned? No. But I'm still really happy with how it turned out. So here's what I did. So the most important thing that I got out of that video was that when you're adding short rows to the bottom of something, you want to start with your longest short row, and then each one after that is going to go a little bit less far. Okay, so your turns are getting closer and closer each time. And to start them, that longest one, she recommends that that's 2/3 of the total circumference of your garment. So what I did was I placed a stitch marker at the very center back of my garment and then counted out the number of stitches that would be 1/3 of the circumference. On this side, place a stitch marker, and 1/3 on this side, place a stitch marker. And then once you have that and you know the number of stitches in between those two turn markers, so 2/3 of your total circumference, that number of stitches, you want to figure out how much height you want your short rows to add. So in this case, I was thinking I wanted to add like roughly this much fabric I thought would do a good job of evening it out. And I think that on my gauge, that turned out to be about 15 rows. And in that video, she basically recommends just evenly distributing your turns across that number of rows. So in this case, I was dividing my number of stitches by 15 rows. Now, when I did this, the mistake that I made was that I was doing my math as if I would be decreasing by this number of stitches on both sides in the same row. So I worked out, okay, if I short turn by 5 stitches each time, that will decrease on this side and this side. So I'm decreasing by 10 stitches each row. This is not the case with short rows, because you're zigzagging. So we go from, if point A is the farthest distance from the center, point B is the next farthest, point C is the next farthest, you're going point A to point A full length, point A to point B, point B to point B, point B to point C, point C to point C. So in fact, in each row, you're not shortening by this number of stitches on both sides. It's only happening on one end at a time. So in fact, the 5 stitch number that I calculated should have been 10 stitches. That would have gotten me the amount of fabric that I was planning to add. Now, I just trusted my math. I wasn't paying a whole lot of attention. I just kept knitting. And at some point I went, I feel like I've added significantly more than this much fabric, and my short turns are still a decent distance from my back center marker. What's happening? So in fact, I ended up adding more length to the back than I intended to. Now, conveniently, I think it looks really nice. I think it looks great with the back longer than the front. It was just not my plan. But so when I realized that was what was happening, I was also visibly starting to run out of yarn. So I was like, am I even gonna get through these? So I then just abandoned the short rows and just kept knitting in the round until I ran out of yarn. I should also mention, if you're curious, I chose to use German short rows when I was doing this, which I think worked pretty well. Like, I can definitely find them if I'm looking for them, but I think that in wearing the garment, it's not obvious. Because mostly, obviously, they're around the back. So yeah, like if I'm really looking, I can find, like that is one of the turns. That is one of the turns. That is one of the turns. So if you know what you're looking for, you can find it, but I chalk that up to similar to like the one I showed you on this sleeve. Like if you're not looking for it, no one is gonna notice these things. So yeah, it kind of just worked out fortuitously that I like the look that my mistake created, but just know, if you're trying to do this math for yourself, just remember you're only decreasing on one side with each short row, not both. So there we have it. This is my finished Cloudbow. Ta-da! I also should note, since this is the last time that I'm featuring this project on the channel, I did also make a teeny tiny modification when I did the neckline and the sleeves that I didn't want to be bothered with sewing it down. So instead, I just folded it over and did a knit two together into the knit stitch where I was folding it down too, and then did a surprisingly stretchy bind off to finish that. So if you too hate sewing things at the end, know that that's an option. All right, so I think that's everything I have to say about my Cloudbow. Now to await my invitation to one of those elusive summer evening garden parties to wear it too. Okay, now it's time to get into our whip. So I'm working on my Fausta bralette, which you can see I've made some real progress on, because last time it just kind of looked like a sweatband. So this is a pattern by Low Key Bold Knit that accommodates up to a 56 inch bust, which we'd love to see go a little bit further. It does have the really awesome benefit of being customizable to fit different bust and under bust measurements, which I think is really, really cool. Now I'm knitting the size 1A, and this pattern costs €7 or about $11 Canadian. In terms of materials, I'm knitting this out of the La Bien-Aimée Felix in the color Winterfell, which is this beautiful dark sort of greeny blue color. And I'm actually knitting this holding two strands of this together, so I have two skeins for the entire project. Now, notably, one of those I acquired for free from a friend's de-stash. Thank you, Amy. So my total yarn cost only reflects one skein, which was about $65 Canadian, about 11 of which was shipping. And combined with the pattern cost, that makes my total project cost about $75 Canadian or about $55 US. So is this a super affordable yarn to knit double-stranded with? I would say no, and I would not be doing it if I hadn't gotten that second skein for free. If you like this idea, but don't have $150 to spend on a tank top, I would recommend looking at non-lace weight yarns that you do not have to hold double to meet gauge here. So for my Fausta top, I have sized up in needles from a 3mm recommended in the pattern to 3.25, which is both because I knit tight always, but also because that's just the smallest needle in my interchangeable needle set. And it just happened that I met gauge with it and didn't have to buy a new needle. So that was great. And I'm calling this actually my Fausta top and not my Fausta bralette, because I have decided that I would like to make it a full length top, which is why I spent so much time on my channel talking about it before I actually cast it on, because to do that, I had to do a bunch of math. Which if you saw my last video, you saw all the math. If you haven't, this will make sense in a minute. But because of the way this is constructed, it's knit in the round bottom up. I kind of had to deal with all these calculations and complications of the length that I wanted to add immediately before I could do anything. But I cast this on July 21st, and considering that this is 2x2 rib knit on the smallest needles that I have, I feel like this is flying. And particularly after spending so much time kind of putting off doing all those calculations and measurements, it's just very exciting to actually see this coming to fruition. So I forgot to put in a progress marker last time, but I believe we were like somewhere around here, maybe. We were not very far. I think I said in that video that we were like somewhere between 1 and 2 inches, and we are definitely past that now. In fact, we are past my waist shaping, which is the thing that I had to do all of those calculations for. So my plan going into this was that I would start at the bottom and I would knit about 4.5 inches, and then I would start my waist shaping, which looks like this, and look how beautiful it is. The look of decreases like this in a 2x2 rib that just come together perfectly into that one column in the center is just so satisfying. It just looks so tidy. And now the way that I did this is not part of the pattern. So I started out by knitting about 4.5 inches in just the straight ribbing, but I cast on more stitches than the pattern called for. Part of my calculations was working out how many stitches should I start with so that I can do the decreasing that I want to do, and then end up at the number of stitches that the pattern tells me that I should have for the portion that's actually above my natural waist. So the way that these decreases are done, and this is not at all part of the pattern, so I feel like there's no problem telling you how I did this. So all you have to do is identify the column of knit stitches that you want all of your decreases to merge into. So see how there's this line that runs right down the center? So I just stuck a stitch marker in between those two knit stitches, and then every time you come to that column, on the right-hand side of the column, you want to do a knit two together with that right-hand knit stitch and the stitch that is to the right of it. And then with the knit stitch that makes up the left side of that column, you want to do a slip-slip knit with it and the stitch to its left. So you're just doing a left-leaning decrease followed by a right-leaning decrease. And each of those decreases uses as one of its stitches one side of that vertical column that they're all merging into. And you make these decreases on every other row. So every other row, you're just gonna knit the round straight. And after you repeat that pattern for 8 rows, so 4 decrease rounds and 4 knit straight rounds, that gives you one complete merge into the main column. I've done that 3 times in order to get 3 sort of branches going into that main column. So according to my calculations, basically as soon as I'm done with the waist shaping, I am now getting into the pattern as it is written. It basically picks up at the point of my waist where the waist shaping finishes off. So the pattern gives a certain number of inches that I'm supposed to knit before I start the gusset for the bust. But I did not want to sort of just trust that number and my measurement of it without doing any testing, because I feel like having shaping in one part of the garment, you can sort of flex to accommodate, you know, if a garment only had bust shaping, the length of it will just sort of land a bit differently depending on how the fabric moves once it's accommodated for fitting the bust area. And in the same way, if I was doing only waist shaping in a fitted top like this, it would have a tendency to sort of find the spot where it fits the waist very naturally, and then the top of the garment would just shift up or down a little depending on exactly where that landed. But when you have it in two places in a snug garment, both of these areas are going to be kind of competing, trying to cinch in and fit. And I feel like there's a potential for example, if I knit the area in between the two shapings too long, that I would end up with bunching at my waist. And if I knit it too short, then either the bust is sort of gonna end up dragging the waist shaping up a little until it starts to sort of sit in a weird place and then bulge out in an area where there's not really any hip there yet, or you know what I mean? I feel like the fact that I'm doing shaping at these two separate heights kind of demands a little bit more accuracy. So I decided that first of all, I needed to try it on very basically just to make sure, okay, is the length that I thought this should be before my waist decreases were done hitting where I thought that it would? Is the number of inches between that and the underbust the number of inches that the pattern is telling me I should knit before I start the bust gusset? But also more critically, is blocking gonna change that? I don't think there was a significant difference in the before and after from when I blocked my swatch, but I don't think it was identical either. And you know, I mean, sometimes something that is so minute as to be kind of imperceptible on a swatch becomes magnified across a garment and starts to add up to something significant. So I decided to do a mid-project block on this one. So this is it following that blocking, plus I think I knit another maybe like 3 rounds after it dried. So when I tried it on, I found that A, the waist shaping fit very well, which I was very excited about, but also B, the total height of it was coming out a little bit shorter than it was measuring before I tried it on, because as we've learned the hard way on this channel, when you stretch things this way, they get smaller this way. And it's not a huge change, and it doesn't mean that the waist shaping doesn't fit. It does, it fits great, but it does mean that I think I might need to knit a little bit of extra height, more than I thought that I was going to need to, before I get to the bust gusset. That said though, when I blocked it, I found that it actually got longer by about half an inch. So we sort of have a push and pull between the blocking is gonna add length, the stretching is gonna take away length, and where exactly do those things meet in the middle? So I think that this is going to be a project where there's going to have to be multiple try-ons and multiple mid-project blocks. Like what I'm thinking is that I am now going to continue until the point where I think it's time to start the gusset, and then I will do another mid-project block just to confirm that when I try it on, that indeed seems like the right time to start the bust gusset. I also, when I finished doing the decreases, I had the thought, you know what? It would be really smart of me to put in a lifeline at this point so that if something were to go wrong after the decreases and I have a hard time picking this up because it is ribbing, it would be really smart if I used that tip that I've seen on other knitting podcasts and never actually tried myself, where you make use of the little tiny hole in your interchangeable needles, stick a thread through there, and then continue knitting for a whole round. And by the time you've done that, your needle has conveniently pulled that thread all around, inserting a perfect lifeline, even though you're knitting ribbing, which would be complicated to insert a lifeline into manually. I was like, you know what? It's finally time to try that hack. Except I was lazy. And where I was sitting, I only had available to me the yarn that I was knitting with. And I was like, is there really any reason why I shouldn't just use this yarn as a lifeline? I mean, yeah, it's the same color. Yeah, it's not gonna stand out, but you know, the tails will be poking out after. It won't be hard to pull it out if I don't need it. And if I need to rip back, it's gonna catch the stitches the same way it would if it was a different color. Is it really? It's fine. I'm sure it's fine. And I'm here to tell you that while in a lot of cases I'm sure it would be fine, it did end up being not ideal for me. So let this be a warning to you if this is something you have thought about only in theory and never done in practice. So here's the issue that I had. I put in the lifeline. That worked great, no problem. I just knit my round, it went all the way through. I did initially, I was like, why does this seem like I still have not gotten very far past it? Like, how is it still in the row below me? How have I not knit more than that? I forgot to take it out of the hole, so it just continued. It was just like spiraling its way up my knitting as I was working. That's not what I wanted to be doing. So realized that, pulled it out of the needle, kept knitting, all was well. But then a couple rows later, I found an issue with one of my stitches. I think I'd purled when I was supposed to knit or knit when I was supposed to purl or whatever. So I dropped the stitch down to go and fix it. And when I did that, I kind of got to the row where my lifeline was. And I realized it's really hard to tell which of these strands is the ladder that I'm supposed to be climbing the stitch back up onto and which is the lifeline. And if I knit it into the lifeline, that's going to be a problem when I remove that lifeline. So when I got there, I was like, okay, I guess I'm removing this lifeline now because I cannot tell which of these strands I'm supposed to be working right now. And this is a reason, maybe there are more, but this is the first reason I ran into of why I would advise doing a lifeline in a contrast color always. Now, another little caution of a thing that I did not realize would happen in inserting a lifeline this way, like by threading it through my needle, is that when I slipped my stitch marker, because I've got a few, I have my beginning of round marker, and I also have my two markers of where the bust gusset's gonna go. When I slipped those onto the needle that the yarn was threaded through the end of, the stitch marker ended up on that strand of yarn. which meant that it was not continuing to travel up my knitting with me the way that it usually would. So for future, if you are inserting a lifeline this way, I would recommend when you get to your stitch markers, take these out and replace them with removable stitch markers so that once you get past the insertion of your lifeline, you can move them up or just pop in your regular circle ones back in their place on your current row and then just remove the removable one from down below. Just hot tip, because I did not realize that these were gonna get trapped. I mean, of course it makes sense when I think about it, I just had not thought that far. So yeah, that's currently where we are with the Fausta bralette. Now I am just knitting straight up the waist for a few inches before I do my second mid-project block to see if it's time to start the bust gusset. And I'm really enjoying working on this one. I like 2x2 rib. It did make it a bit harder at the cottage to be reading and knitting at the same time, but it's still definitely doable. It just requires a little bit more checking to make sure that I haven't made mistakes, but once in a while I catch a mistake and then I just ladder down and fix it with a crochet hook and it's fine. So it's not a big deal. So I'm excited about how this one's turning out. So far things are going really well, knock on wood with all of my shaping, and I'm hoping that it continues to go that way. Okay, it's time for acquisitions and future plans. So if you saw my summer knitting plans video, you know that I have been eyeing up the Sailor Swift top by Veronica Lindberg. I mentioned that I have a tank top that looks very similar to this that is very worse for wear. So I am looking forward to hopefully replacing that with one that I have knit myself. And we are getting closer to that reality because I have yarn. So first, let's just do a quick pattern rundown. So the Sailor Swift top is designed by Veronica Lindberg. And this is a pattern that accommodates up to a 59.5 inch bust. Now I will be knitting the size extra small, and in terms of cost, this pattern is regularly 590 in euros, but I got it half off because as part of AKA Nora Knits 10,000 subscriber giveaway celebration thing, that included a coupon code from Veronica Lindberg for 50% off any of her patterns. So I actually got it for 295 euros or about $440 Canadian. Now, as far as materials, I've decided to knit this out of the Knitting for Olive Pure Silk in the colorway Putty for my main color and Brown Bear for my second color. So my idea in using both of these colors is that it's going to give sort of the effect of a black and white striped top, but in a warmer, slightly earthier kind of palette. And I'm hoping that Putty is like far enough for my skin color that it's not gonna look weird, but I am very pale, so cross your fingers for me. So I was hoping to buy this from the knitting loft that's local to me in Toronto, but they've actually been sold out of most colors of pure silk for a while. I suspect they had their big run on like summer yarns and then haven't really restocked because fall is around the corner. So I was kind of dreaming about like going into the shop and browsing around and looking at all the nice things, and then I'll probably just buy this one thing I knew I was there to buy, but I will have had the experience of the glorious yarn shop. And then I couldn't get them there. And then I kind of kept checking for a few weeks, and I got to the point where I was like, okay, I feel like I'm gonna be casting this on sooner than later, and I don't wanna be in a position where I'm sitting around waiting for yarn. So I went ahead and ordered it online instead from Fia Fia, which I believe is also like a small independent yarn shop based in Quebec. So I did not get my lovely browsy yarn store experience. And to be fair, I could still go and do that. It's just a little bit harder to convince myself to get there when I don't have like a specific goal of buying something, but that's not their fault. So from Fia Fia, these three balls of yarn cost me $50.68 Canadian plus $12 in shipping, which brings our total project cost of the yarn plus pattern to about $55 Canadian or about $40 US. And now that I have this, I really need to knit a swatch to figure out what needle I should be using, because historically I need to size up because I tend to knit tight, but I've also never knit with silk before. So I really don't know what to expect with that. I know that it is significantly less stretchy than a wool yarn. It has like no give to it. So I don't know if or how that's going to affect my gauge. I also don't know if that's going to affect how much I enjoy working on it, because I've definitely heard other knitting podcasts that I love to watch talk about the fact that it's so inelastic makes it harder on your hands than wool is to work with. But I think that the degree to which that bothers people varies quite a lot. So I don't really know how I'm gonna feel about it. And because of that, I'm kind of debating, despite the fact that like instinctively, I kind of just wanna focus on my current whip. I'm like, should I be casting this on just to get a sense of what it feels like so that if it's not great, I can then alternate back and forth between projects when my hands feel like they need a break from the silk. I feel like that might be a good strategy. I think actually, maybe what I will do is I will knit a swatch to get that figured out. And maybe that experience of knitting the swatch will give me enough information to determine, will I be happy working on only this for a few weeks and wait and do that after my current whip, or should I really be casting this on now so I can go back and forth? I think that's going to be my sort of project on the Sailor Swift top over the next couple of weeks. So the Sailor Swift top, it's been in my favorites since Veronica Lindberg released it last year, but it's really been fresh in my mind since I just watched AK and Nora Knits knit hers, and it just seemed like such a lovely sort of easy breezy knitting process. Construction wise, you start out knitting flat, working your back panel, and then you, I believe, pick up stitches from the back panel to knit the two sides of the front, and then you join everything in the round, and then you're just working straight down from there. Now, the part of this project that will be really new to me besides the materials is stripes. I've never knit stripes, which seems funny. Like, I've done intarsia color work, but I haven't just done simple stripes, and I love stripes. I kind of worry that this is going to be a gateway because I love striped clothing, and I fear that my love of striped clothing paired with the way that I hear people talk about the addictive nature of knitting stripes, the sort of just one more stripe of it all, I fear that this might be the start of me knitting like nothing but stripes for the foreseeable future. But you know what? I love stripes. I will wear them. So maybe that's fine. But I am very curious to find how I feel about knitting stripes, because I don't love any time I have to switch colors in a project. That's just not my favorite thing. But I have been known to deal with far worse yarn color changing situations when motivated by a finished product. So really don't think it'll bug me in this project. I think it'll be more just a question of, do I find that knitting stripes is a thing that I love and now I'm gonna start seeking out stripe projects? Or am I like, okay, that's enough. So yeah, stay tuned for progress on the Sailor Swift top. All right, now it's time for Off the Needles, where we talk about creative things that are not knitting, though I mean really 90% of the time it's a book segment. Today it is in fact a book segment. So today I do not actually have a finished object to talk about in the book segment because I made a mistake. So I tend to read one book at a time. Much like my knitting, I don't really tend to like to split my attention a whole lot. So last time we talked, I was in the middle of Lies and Weddings. Actually, to say in the middle is a vast overstatement. I was about 30 pages into Lies and Weddings, and I got a little bit further than that. I got to page 92. Also, behold, speaking of creative things, this is a bookmark that my nephew Chase painted for me. I really love it. He really like leans into the abstract in his work, which is not a concept that like ever occurred to me as a child. Absolutely everything was figurative. And as an adult, I love abstract art. So I really appreciate that Chase has figured out the beauty of abstract art early in life. So anyway, I was about 90 pages into this book and I was packing for a weekend at my family's cottage. And I was like, okay, this is a chunk of a book. It's not an extreme amount of pages. It's like 435-ish pages, but it's quite fine print. So like word count wise, it's on the higher end of a 435 page book. And I was just thinking, okay, if I bring this book with me, like there's not really any chance that I'm coming home from this weekend having finished the book. But you know what recently came in the mail? Rainbow Rowell's new book. And I mean, I think page count wise, it's quite similar. I mean, this one is, it's a little bit shorter. I mean, it's 390 pages, it's 45 pages, not dramatic, but it's also significantly larger print. And also her stories tend to be much more sort of zoomed in on a very small cast of characters. And I have talked before about how I really enjoy that Kevin Kwan manages to do big cast stories in a way that actually keep me engaged and following what's going on. But I do feel like as far as books that I'm dipping in and out of all day long while other people are around and periodically talking to me, I felt like it would be significantly more of a struggle with this book than with this one. And I was like, if I bring this book, I feel like I have a really good chance of ripping through a book in a weekend, which I just love that feeling. I just always feel really happy when I get to really sink into a book for a couple days and just tear through it. But joke's on me because I only got about halfway through. So I now have two whips. I'm in the middle of two books, which is not a place I love to be. And now I get to play the game of which book do I get back into first? I don't know. So I've already talked a decent amount about this book on the channel, particularly for a book that I'm not even 100 pages into. So I'm not gonna talk more about that today. If you wanna know more about this one, feel free to pop back to my last video to hear. But Slow Dance by Rainbow Rowell. So this is a book that I pre-ordered. I've been psyched about this one. I adore Rainbow Rowell's writing. She is kind of written all over the map. I initially got into her as a YA writer, but then found out that she had written an adult rom-com. So then I went back and read that. And then she got into new adult. And then I think wrote an adult book and then started writing YA fantasy. So like I have gone with her all over the map with her books because I just love her voice so much. The only books of hers that I haven't read are the, I think, second and third books in the Simon Snow trilogy, because it is fantasy, which is just not really my thing. But I love her enough that I was curious to check out the first one and enjoyed it more than I would the average fantasy book, but just still wasn't like super into it. So I didn't pick up the second and third ones. So I'm so excited to see her back in the world of writing contemporary. Her sort of new adult book Fangirl is one of my absolute favorite books of all time. Like I don't reread books very often, but I have read that book at least three times and I have loved it equally every single time. So I was so ready for her return to the world of contemporary fiction. And this one is an adult rom-com. Is it a rom-com? I mean, I don't know if it's so much the com, but it's also not like dark. Just a rom, but also not like a raunchy rom. I don't know how to categorize a lot of adult fiction. I feel much more familiar with the world of YA fiction and how it gets categorized. So I don't actually know what this book is categorized as. I do know that it was one of Reese's book picks. I peeled that sticker off. I did leave on though the sticker that says that it's a signed first edition because I did specifically pre-order the signed edition. So the signature is at the front here. I find it funny though, because it has this line here that says, this signed edition has been specially bound by the publisher. And I don't know, something about that, something about there being this special page that the publisher like made and put in for her to sign, it just feels like weird to me. As far as I can tell, this is all kind of a trickle down of, and maybe I'm giving him too much credit for this because he's the one that I pay attention to, but as far as I can tell, John Green popularized the concept of signing your entire first edition of a book when he first put out The Fault in Our Stars, and he's since gone on to do it with books after that as well, with like increasingly absurd first edition numbers. Like I think for Turtles All the Way Down, he was signing like 100,000 copies or something absurd like that. So I think that that's where this is coming from, and I know that when he did it, his publisher was sending him boxes full of blank pieces of paper that would later be bound into the book so that they weren't sending him 100,000 hardcover books to his house. Makes sense. But something about the having a paper that specifically says, we put in this page so she would sign it for you, just makes me feel like a little bit like disingenuous somehow. Not on her part, like Rainbow, thank you so much for signing all of these books. I really appreciate the time and effort that you put into that. I just wish that your publisher hadn't been so sort of like self-congratulatory about it. I don't know, it's just a weird vibe to me, but I digress. I also got to meet Rainbow several years ago at this point. It was actually, I think, for her fangirl book tour. So, okay, let me do some time math. I was in third year university, which would have been either like 2013, 2014. So like, oh God, that's a whole decade ago. But she was so lovely. And if I remember right, she was wearing this pair of sort of like retro red Mary Jane heels. And I complimented her on her shoes and then we talked about shoes. So that was my like 30-second interaction with Rainbow Rowell, and she was lovely. And true to form with all of her books, I am loving this story so far. As implied by the slow dance title, it's sort of a slow burn romance of two high school best friends who sort of had like a would they or won't they going on at the time, but never quite did. And then are reunited 15 years later at one of their mutual friends' weddings. And it's just so good. I might have to finish this one before I finish Lies and Weddings. I am further into this one than I am into Lies and Weddings, so I don't think this says anything about Lies and Weddings, but I am feeling really invested in this one and wanting to get to the end of it first, I think. And then in a perhaps shocking turn of events, I do not have any new book acquisitions to share today, though I don't get a lot of credit for that because I literally got an email like an hour ago that one of my pre-orders is out for delivery as we speak. So any moment now I will have a new book acquisition, but I will wait until you book that when I like physically have it. So that's all on the book front. All right, that's all I've got for you today. So thank you so much for coming in it with me. If you like this video and feel like clicking the like button, that really helps me out. If you'd like to be here next time, please consider subscribing if you're not already. And if you are, you're my favorite. I'll see you soon. Bye.